Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. One of the most terrifying periods in Jewish history was certainly the decades leading up to the Gerush Sfard, the massive expulsion of the Jews from the Iberian Peninsula. And I'd like to look today at two transitional figures who represent that unusual moment of moving from Spain into Portugal and then finally to the land of Israel. I find them deeply inspirational, and I've actually spent quite a bit of time studying their work. I'm in particular fascinated by Rabbi Yaakov ibn Shlomo Habib, whose years are roughly 1445 to 1515, and his son as well, named Levi, who continued his legacy in the holy city of Tzfat in northern Israel. So what's the story with them? Rabbi Yaakov ibn Shlomo Habib was born in Zamora, which is in Castile, and he was the Rosh Yeshiva in, among other places, Salamanca, very beautiful university town that had a major Jewish community right up until the expulsion of 1492. When the expulsion occurred, he was among the large group of Jews that made the land journey just to the west. Salamanca is actually within a very short driving distance of the, it's actually close to the Douro River, so you can get along the Douro River Valley right into Portugal. And that's where he went, along with maybe some 60,000 Jews who fled from Spain. And at that time, Portugal was initially, with some hesitancy, willing to accept some of these refugees, albeit for a large payment. And some Jews were able to put together the money. Many others simply entered Portugal illegally as refugees from the expulsion. Then in 1497, as we've discussed many times, there was a forced conversion, a mass baptism of all of these Jews in Portugal, which created an entirely different kind of environment where they were suddenly, you know, given the privileges of Jewish status, but still burdened by the social prejudices against them as Jews, and that, of course, they were not willingly baptized to Catholicism. And this would be reasonably tolerable on some levels until the 1530s, when the Inquisition entered Portugal, and then they were actively persecuted for harboring any Jewish practices. Then the next 200 years has some absolutely horrific stories, which hopefully we'll be able to understand a little more of over the course of these lectures, and especially when we're in Portugal later this year. Now, Rabbi Yaakov ibn Shlomo Habib was among those who was forcibly converted. He fled Portugal in 1501 with his family, and he made his way to Salonika, Greece, where he was able to get together with the community of Spanish exiles there, who elected him as their rabbi, and he spent the majority of the later years of his life in Salonika there. He was a very well-respected rabbi, quoted by many of the great rabbis of the era, including the Spanish Rabbi Yosef Caro, the author of the Shulchan Aruch. The most important and lasting literary creation that he bequeathed the Jewish people was a fantastic book called Ein Yaakov, or The Well of Jacob. He, of course, was named Jacob Yaakov. And this is a really interesting thing, because you have to understand how the Talmud is constructed. The Talmud, massive document, right? Thousands and thousands of pages. And it has a very unusual structure in which it's kind of like a stream of consciousness discussion with up to 2,000 interlocutors. And the tangents are sometimes more numerous than the actual, you know, straightforward description of the text or subject involved. And so what that means is, besides the discussions of how should Jews behave in a ritual and civil and moral fashion, there are all kinds of like sort of side discussions that are like philosophical musings or metaphysical meditations or stories, biographies, jokes, recipes, observations on the natural world. I mean, all kinds of amazing, wonderful, unusual things are mixed in with the rest of the discussion. Now, for many rabbis, for several hundred years preceding Rabbi Ibn Habib, There was kind of like a desire to sort of push away all that sort of secondary material that does not seem at least directly related to the subject at hand. And so you have collections like the one by Rav Alfasi, in which all of that stuff is edited out of the Talmud, and you have only the halachic information, only the Jewish law information, which of course is a much easier way to make your way through the Talmud, but it's also kind of less interesting, in my humble opinion. It's just the law, the law, the law, as opposed to all this fascinating stories about great rabbis and experiences they had and things like that. So what Rabbi Yaakov ibn Habib did, and maybe he was thinking a lot about his generation and what they needed, he went the other way. And he said, no, no, you know what? All that halachic, all that legal material is very useful, but I'm going to create a work that's the only the fun parts of the Talmud, only the biographies and recipes and observations on what we can learn from the behavior of a cat and things like that. And he put that in a distinct edited version of the Talmud called Ein Yaakov. And it is absolutely fascinating to go through this. Now, to really study the Talmud properly, in my humble opinion, you have to do both, because they are interrelated, sometimes in a very, you know, tangential way, but both types of material are very much related. But the Ein Yaakov proved to be extremely popular because, especially for people who, you know, did not have the necessarily the mental stamina to go through long, months-long discussions of halachic, you know, sometimes theory, and they just wanted to get this more inspirational material from the Talmud, the Ein Yaakov was perfect. It also has a commentary. It's not just the edited Talmud, but the Ein Yaakov includes Rabbi Ibn Habib's commentary on it, which has fantastic historical data, especially relating to the experiences of the Jews who had to flee Spain and Portugal. So he finished it, and it was published in 1516 after his death, and has been reprinted more than 10 different editions and hundreds of reprintings since then. However, he did not merit to finish the entire book. That was left to his son, Levi. Levi, like his father, was born in Spain, and he made his way to Portugal, and then at the tender age of 14, he was among those, like his father, who were forcibly converted to Catholicism. He followed his father to Salonika, and then, in the spirit of the age, because there was a huge widespread feeling among Jews that something colossal had happened, something that, you know, we can understand a little bit of that in the sense of like being in the post-Holocaust generations, that something had dramatically shifted in the tectonic structure of the universe. And Levi ibn Habib said, in order to atone for whatever it was that led to that moment of baptism, he went to live in the land of Israel. He went to Tzfat and then later in Jerusalem, where he was very much involved in a fascinating controversy. He was the opponent of Rabbi Yaakov Beirav, who in Tzfat was trying to restart historical smicha. Absolutely fascinating, but he managed to finish his father's work, the Ein Yaakov, and it is a classic that for the last 500 years has been studied with great enthusiasm by many, including myself. Okay, I hope you found this useful, and thank you very much for watching.